Welcome to the Frontiers of Flight Museum's virtual Honoring Our Nation's Heroes event. My name is Dan Steelman, and I'm Vice President of Collections and Exhibits at the museum. 75 years ago, our nation celebrated the end of World War II as the Japanese Empire formally and unconditionally surrendered aboard the battleship USS Missouri in Tokyo Bay. Join us on the museum's Facebook page and YouTube beginning at 10 a.m. today, Central Daylight Time, as we hear stories of those who served from World War II to today's modern military warriors. Special thanks to the Luckadoo family for sponsoring our keynote speaker today, Lieutenant Commander John Miller, former U.S. Navy Blue Angel solo pilot who served with distinction as an A-6 intruder pilot during the Vietnam War. Today would not be possible without the generous support of UPS, the Perot Foundation, and Erik Johnston Photography. We thank each organization for their desire to honor our nation's heroes.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Welcome to the Lucky Luckadoo Lecture Series. I am John H. Lucky Luckadoo, a member of the infamous 100th Bomb Group, otherwise known as the Bloody 100th, who flew in England with the 8th Air Force in World War II. Grateful to be here, and especially to be here with you. Today, I'm privileged to introduce to you our speaker, Lieutenant Commander John Miller, also a veteran, but of a different war and a different generation, the Vietnam War. Afterwards, he also served with distinction as a member of the Blue Angels, which I'm sure you're familiar with, and will be very interested in hearing what he has to say about his experiences under both commands. Without further ado, Lieutenant Commander John Miller.
Thank you, Lucky. It's a pleasure to be here at the Frontiers of Flight Museum and an honor to participate in the Luckadoo Lecture Series paying tribute to our nation's heroes. We are blessed to live in freedom in this great country, won by the dedication and sacrifice of those who have served and those that are serving in our armed forces. Today, September 2nd, marks the 75th anniversary of the surrender of Japan and the end of World War II. While the great wealth, resources, and industrial power of our country gave us the means to prevail in that conflict, it was the unity and sacrifice of our people, our heroes, that made the ultimate difference. As a Navy veteran, I would like to share with you some of my experiences from one of my Navy assignments, an organization that came from the flight deck of aircraft carriers, the Blue Angels. Aviation emerged as a dominant weapon in World War II with the advent of long-range bombers and aircraft carriers that were able to project force over long distances. But after the war, all the services, including the Navy, were downsizing and losing funding. At the same time, there was a lot of talk about a separate Air Force being created from the Army. The Navy needed to maintain public support for funding, recruiting for personnel, and a presence in the heartland of America away from the coasts. Consequently, in 1946, by direction of Admiral Chester Nimitz, then Chief of Naval Operations, orders were given to form a Navy flight demonstration team. Butch Forrest, a World War II fighter ace who served from the Battle of Santa Cruz, Guadalcanal, and in all the major carrier engagements in the Pacific to Okinawa, was chosen to form the team and become its first leader. The initial cadre of pilots for the flight demonstration team would all come from carrier-based veterans of the Pacific Campaign. The team flew its first air show on June 15, 1946, at Craig Field outside Jacksonville, Florida. It was not until later in the July that the team took the name Blue Angels, the inspiration coming from a bar of the same name in New York City. The Blue Angels have flown air shows continuously since 1946, except for a period from mid-1950 through 1951, when the team was ordered to combat-ready status, forming the nucleus of Fighter Squadron 191 serving in Korea. From the beginning, the Blue Angels relied on teamwork, constant practice, and individual ability to bring the maneuvers they learned during aerial combat to low altitude so that the public could see and appreciate the precision involved in naval aviation. Their official charter was to demonstrate the precision techniques of naval aviation to military personnel and, as directed, to the public. However, through the years, the team has always been involved in the recruiting effort, and it became more critical with the advent of the all-volunteer armed forces in the early 1970s. Today, the team's primary mission is recruiting. The composition of the Blue Angels is similar to any naval aviation squadron, except that each person serving on the team goes through a selection process. I was selected for the Blue Angels in September 1975 and served with the team for 3 years, from 1976 to 1978. All pilots selected for the team are fleet experienced carrier aviators who have served in either fighter or attack squadrons. The selection process for the wingmen, numbers 2 through 6, are peer reviewed and selected by the team members. The commanding officer and leader, number 1, known as the boss, is selected by the Chief of Naval Air Training. Each year, the Blue Angels turn over 3 of the 6 demonstration pilots. As 3 new pilots are selected and join the team, the 3 pilots concluding their 2nd year move on to other assignments in the Navy. This turnover requires an intensive training regimen known as winter training, which begins immediately after the conclusion of the air show season in late fall. Even though the new pilots selected for the team are experienced carrier pilots, there is a steep learning curve required to master close formation flying while performing acrobatic maneuvers low to the ground. The winter training cycle, which begins at the team's home base in Pensacola, Florida, moves to El Centro, California in early January. El Centro is in the Imperial Valley, where the weather is favorable for uninterrupted training. From the beginning of the winter training, the team flies approximately 120 training flights before performing the first air show of the new season. The training is very intense, and the team literally concentrates on flying 24/7. With each day of training, aspects of new maneuvers are introduced, techniques are refined, altitudes are lowered, and the aircraft are moved closer together. This is all done at a very measured and deliberate pace. Before each flight, there is a thorough brief, and after the flight, an intensive debrief aided by video taken of each training flight. The new pilots work on learning maneuvers and perfecting their craft, while the second-year pilots focus on training the new pilots while continuing to hone their own skills to a finer level. Initially, the Diamond pilots, numbers 1 through 4, train separately from the Solo pilots, numbers 5 and 6. This is done because there are different skill sets and maneuvers that need to be learned. In the latter stages of winter training, all 6 pilots train together in the 6-plane Delta formation. At the same time, work on sequencing of diamond and solo maneuvers takes place to form the choreography of the air show. At the beginning of the air show season, normally in mid-March, the team is ready to perform its first show to Blue Angel standards. But at this point in the season, the learning curve is still steep, and the team is constantly refining the air show. In reality, work never ceases on improving the performance. Each team member strives to fly perfectly and meticulously debriefed after each flight. It is constant search for perfection that motivates the team during the long air show season. The perfect air show is like searching for closure on an asymptotic curve, where the curved line approaches closer and closer to the straight line, but never touches. As pilots, we took great satisfaction when there were very few flaws in our performance and we achieved near perfection. Over the years, the team has flown a wide variety of aircraft, starting with the F-6F Hellcat, the Navy's frontline fighter from World War II. The transition to jets was made in mid-1949, with the introduction of the Grumman F9F2 Panther jet. Without the big aluminum cutting propeller in the front of the aircraft, the team was able to significantly tighten the formation. The Blue Angels have now flown the F-18 Hornet since 1987. The aircraft I flew with the team was the A-4F Skyhawk. It was affectionately known as Heinemann's Hot Rod, named after its famed designer, Ed Heinemann of Douglas Aircraft. It was designed as a light attack aircraft and served operationally in the fleet from 1956 until the mid-1970s. The aircraft was durable, extremely maneuverable, and very responsive on the controls. Its power-to-weight ratio, 1-to-1 in the Blue Angel configuration before adding fuel, exceptional roll rate, and inverted flight capability made the aircraft a solo pilot's dream. Because of its maneuverability, the A4 air show was tighter than that of the F4 Phantom, the aircraft it replaced. Bringing the air show closer to the spectators was a crowd pleaser, as was the shorter interval of time between maneuvers. The air show itself is a combination of close formation maneuvers flown by the four Diamond pilots and high-speed, opposing, and high-performance maneuvers flown by the two solo pilots. In the latter stages of the air show, the pilots join together to fly in the six aircraft Delta formation. Each pilot is dependent on the other to put their aircraft in the correct position and fly smoothly through the loops, rolls, and opposing maneuvers. There is very little margin for error, which accentuates the need for precise teamwork, constant practice, and trust. What the team demonstrates in the air show is a microcosm of the teamwork and skill necessary to conduct flight operations on the deck of an aircraft carrier. The Diamond formation is the signature of the Blue Angels and is displayed from the start of the air show with the Diamond formation takeoff. Early in the air show, the four Diamond pilots perform a maneuver called the 360, a curving arc performed in very tight formation, low in front of the spectators, to display the tight wingtip to canopy clearance flown by the wingman. The team flies a combination of maneuvers to please the general spectator and impress the seasoned pilot. The demonstration pilots are always cognizant that they are representing the Navy and Naval and Marine Corps Aviation. As a solo pilot, some of my favorite maneuvers were challenging, but what I considered noteworthy to the discerning pilot. One of these maneuvers was the back-to-back roll, where the two solo aircraft are in mirror image formation, one flying inverted and the other upright while performing a 360-degree rolling maneuver. Others were the tuck-over and tuck-away breaks, with both solo pilots flying inverted formation at 100 feet, followed by a 270-degree blind roll around the longitudinal axis of the aircraft. The tuck-over break had both aircraft rolling in the same direction, while in the tuck-away break, the aircraft rolled toward one another and then separated at the completion of the rolls. Another maneuver is one where, as lead solo, number 5, I joined the four Diamond pilots in the line-abreast loop. This maneuver is difficult because it is flown looking 90 degrees from the flight path of the aircraft. Now, there is always good-natured ribbing on the team between the Diamond and Solo pilots, relating primarily to the importance and difficulty of each position. Consequently, I was pleased to join the Diamond for this maneuver. The five-plane line-abreast loop is flown by the team to this day. In a normal season, the Blue Angels fly approximately 70 air shows and serve as goodwill ambassadors for the Navy, attending civic functions, visiting hospitals, and giving presentations at high schools and trade schools. This year has been difficult because of the pandemic, and the team has not been able to fly air shows due to the restrictions on large gatherings. However, they have been able to perform flyovers in many large metropolitan areas as part of Operation America Strong. As evidenced by the amount of national and local press coverage these flyovers received, it is apparent they were very successful in displaying American pride and honoring our frontline healthcare workers. The excitement the Blue Angels create promoting goodwill and representing the Navy underscores the underlying reasons why the team was formed 74 years ago. This is a watershed year for the Blues. After flying the first generation F-18 for 33 years, they are preparing to transition to the new F-18E Super Hornet for the 2021 airshow season. The retirement of the first generation aircraft presents a rare opportunity for museums to acquire one of them for display. Fortunately, the Frontiers of Flight Museum has been designated to receive one of these aircraft. Unfortunately, the pandemic has impacted the museum's ability to raise funds for this purpose. I am a member of an organization that has stepped in to help. Last year, the DFW Tailhookers Association made a commitment to the Frontiers of Flight Museum to bring an EA-6B Prowler to the museum for display, which we did in March 2019. This year, we made another commitment to bring a Blue Angel F-18 to the museum for permanent display. The aircraft that is coming to the museum is still flying with the team, but will be retired in October. We need your help to raise funds necessary for the relocation and setup of the aircraft. Time is running short. Our commitment to accept the aircraft must be made by mid-September. Please consider a donation so that we may bring this symbol of American pride to Dallas's Frontiers of Flight Museum. Donations may be made on our website, dfwtailhookers.org. For 26 years, my sister Susan served in the Veterans Administration, caring for veterans and making their lives better each day. Today, I would like to recognize her as my personal hero. We all have heroes in our lives, and today is a good day to reach out and thank them. To all of our nation's heroes, thank you, and God bless America.